This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Well, today on Dreamland, we have a guest who has been with us before. William Stillman, has worked professionally as a psychic medium and spiritual counselor since 2004. His accuracy in discerning the truth and making predictions that come to fruition has been acclaimed by his clients as truly extraordinary. He has been consulted on missing persons, unsolved homicide cases, and is an award-winning author of 10 special needs parenting books, as well as a very accomplished psychic. And today we are going to be talking about his book, The Practicing Psychic. It is a guide for staying grounded, navigating skeptics, and as he puts it so beautifully on the cover, honoring your gift. This is not a show about how to become a psychic. This, we are going to be talking about the practice of being a psychic, as I know many of you are. Bill, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you so much for having me back, Whitley, and it's terrific to see you one-on-one, face-to-face. I know we've chatted in the past before, but it's wonderful to connect in this way.
Bill, before we go on, where can people find you on the internet?
Thank you. People can find me at williamstillman.com. My Facebook page is William Stillman Psychic Medium, and every morning I put up an original inspirational quote that I receive in my meditations on my daily walks. And I also have a YouTube channel, which is simply William Stillman.
I'm writing all this down.
Oh, thank you. So that's williamstillman.com. Facebook is William Stillman Psychic Medium, four words. YouTube is simply William Stillman. Now, I've done a series of excursions to the Gettysburg battlefield because I live about an hour from there. And I am ignorant of Civil War history. And so I have an expert with me on those trips, and we go to various locations, and I'm, you know, intuiting all sorts of things, and then the experts are there to verify. And that's been fascinating.
My goodness. Well, you don't mention that in the book, I don't think.
I don't? But I think I do, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I didn't see it. I've got 30 questions for you.
Oh, wonderful.
But before we go there, I want to hear more about Gettysburg. That's fascinating, William.
It's fascinating to me, too. Listen, I get blown away. As I said, forgive me, I don't mean to offend any historians, but that era in time just doesn't resonate with me. It's just not my area of special interest. My interests lie elsewhere. And so I ended up connecting with an author who had written a book on a specific farm out in Gettysburg that had served as a makeshift hospital over the course of the several-day battle. And we went out to the farm and the property and the barn, and it was extraordinary. And after that, we regretted that we hadn't had someone there with us videotaping everything. And so future trips, we made sure that someone was with us. And I've been out there most recently with another historian, and all sorts of extraordinary things that I am seeing and hearing and feeling and smelling and tasting.
Well, we'll get into all of those different types of clairvoyance, but and you found you would see things, or you would have experiences, psychic experiences on the battlefield,
yeah.
And you would then report this to the historian?
Yes, indeed. And again, you know, I know Gone with the Wind, and that's about it. So I really don't have I really don't have a foundation of knowledge. for what occurred at Gettysburg. And I was picking up on names and also some things that were later verified that we were able to insert into the videos on cards just to sort of update folks. So, for example, standing in the middle of a field and quote unquote seeing a dog run past us with something in its mouth. And I said, would they have used dogs as messengers between camps or something like that? And my friend, the author, didn't know, but researched it and found out that indeed they did do that. So things of that nature, the little, you know, minutiae details that are just fascinating to me personally.
That is remarkable. I never knew that myself, and I have studied Gettysburg. My brother's quite interested in it, and he's told me a lot about it as well. Now, let's do this, though. People can see this material on your YouTube channel. Is that right?
Yes, there are, gosh, I don't know how many videos taken at Gettysburg. And then there are also videos of me working with audiences and groups of people just doing, you know, typical psychic stuff.
Yeah, well, you do gallery readings.
I do.
As well.
It's my favorite thing in the world to do.
Well, let me ask you a question before we go on. I'm sure this is going to be of interest to my listeners and viewers. What about now, during COVID? Are you able to do readings over, like, Zoom?
Yes. Whitley, COVID has been a real learning curve for me, I'll tell you, because typically before, I would sit next to my client for in-person sessions. I would take their hand in mine, and I've had to revise all of that. You know, we've had to sit 6 feet apart. We've had to wear masks. I'm no longer able to touch them. And I've been doing online sessions using Skype primarily, which is my preferred mode. And with people all over the country, all of the United States, but also all over the world. And the most fascinating thing is that all of these little crutches have sort of fallen away from me, and it's made absolutely no difference in terms of the authenticity and the accuracy of the work.
So it was really, it turns out that it was something you felt, but not something that you needed.
Exactly.
The hands-on kind of thing.
Exactly. The only other time something similar like to this happened, Whitley, was a few years ago. I was getting ready to go into a gallery event, and I was preparing for that. And I used to wear a bracelet that had some scriptures written on it. I can do all things through Christ and so on. And as I was getting up to walk out the door to enter the room to start the event, it broke from my wrist and fell to the floor. And so, again, there was another crutch that fell by the wayside. And the message has been, just rely on the God working through you, because it doesn't come from me, it comes through me.
Ah, and that's such a key, that it comes through you.
Terribly important.
Terribly important, and we're going to get into how this all works for you and how that relates to other people who are psychics, and some people who are probably wanting to be psychics. And you mentioned, you don't make any specific reference in the book, and we're not going to be talking about the how-to, but I'm wondering if you have any, to someone who's not a psychic and wants to start, what is your initial advice as to how to go about that? This book that you've written is terribly important to anyone who is a psychic or is exploring becoming one, because it's really about the practice, and it's powerful, useful stuff. But answer the question first, if I may.
Yes, it starts with this. Bottom line, it's not rocket science. It's very, very simple, and it is accessible to us all if you desire it. And we've talked before. I've been on your program talking about another book that I wrote called Under Spiritual Siege, about ghosts and demons. And in that book, I tell the story about, you know, having been an extremely, exquisitely, painfully sensitive little boy, and all sorts of strange things happening around me as a kid. And then all of that got blocked up for being bullied and abused for many years. And so for me, I came at being a psychic medium in a, through a very circuitous route, and didn't actually start doing this until I was in my early 40s. So very much a late bloomer. But the most powerful and important thing that I did, Whitley, was I acknowledged and reclaimed and reconnected a relationship with God, about whom I had been completely indifferent and dismissive for decades. And once I made that commitment, and once I began to enter into a period of self-assessment and personal analysis in terms of atoning for all of my bad behavior and misconduct, and then also acknowledging what I had done to contribute to the greater good, that's when it all shot through the roof. It was like someone or something was just waiting for that moment of awakening. They were probably cheering, saying, oh, finally, he got it. After all this time, he got it. And I made up for decades in about 3 months or less. I was on the fast track for sure. Extraordinarily powerful experience. Nightly dreams where I was being mentored, where I was being given problems to solve, spiritual problems to solve. I was being shown the best and the worst of human nature. Synchronicities were starting to abound all around me. And that's when I began to do the work professionally.
Let's go back to your childhood, if we may, and tell us about some of the experiences that you just referred to, and that I guess interrupted your normal life and made you, you know, like a lot. I mean, most of those of the psychics who are listening now are probably nodding and yeah, that happened to me. So tell us a little bit about that.
Yes. Well, I would have premonitory dreams. For example, I remember a couple of occasions having a dream where I would be standing on the front lawn of my home, and I would start picking pennies up out of the grass, and then the very next day do that. And that that happened twice in two separate locations. Very odd.
So yeah, you must have found that kind of nice, actually, as a little boy.
I had a lot of deja vu, let me tell you, a lot of moments of deja vu, a lot of flashes of predictions that came to fruition. And it wasn't around death or dying or anything tragic like that, like some people have experienced. But it was just, I didn't really think to question it, because I didn't realize it was anything any different from the average person. But, you know, when you're that sensitive in a little boy, that doesn't go over so well with your peers, especially other little boys, and particularly as you're growing and maturing. And so by the time I was about 11, you know, pre-adolescent, that's when people tend to become a little bit more sophisticated, a little bit more cliquish and judgmental and so on. And boy, was I odd man out. And so unfortunately, that led into a very dark period of time for me, when all of those sensitivities that I had experienced in childhood, which were really rather pleasant. And, you know, sometime I'll have to talk about my earliest memory of, you know, seeing a little man, I guess I would call it, while I was trying to sleep in a crib. But all of that stuff got blocked up. And because I was being abused every day, I was being hazed, verbally abused, physically harassed. My speech and body language were openly mocked and mimicked in front of adults who really didn't do anything at all to prevent it. And that went on for about 7 to 8 years of my life. And so, unfortunately, I became attracted to dark things. And dark things found me loud and clear. And we've talked about all that before, the phantom that I saw that I later found out was seen by, you know, countless people around the world when I was 11. You know, The Exorcist had just come out. I was fascinated to know everything I possibly could about that. And then really strange things started happening to me that were not healthy and not pleasant.
Well, we will, since you've brought this up, we're going to review it briefly. But we're going to do that, Free Dreamlanders, right after this break.
Support UnknownCountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
How curious are you? How much do you really want to know about the world you live in? There are, for example, very real conspiracies. We're talking about one of them today. And this is a place where if it's real, we're going to talk about it, but not if it's not real. So there's no confusion here. If we're talking conspiracy on Dreamland and on unknowncountry.com, it's because we can prove it, just like we can prove that the Roswell incident has been covered up. We can prove these things. We can prove that the abduction phenomena is in some way very real. We can prove that there are unusual materials in this world because some of them are right here in my possession. So, this is an unusual place. It's a unique place. And above all, it is a great place to explore. Exploring the unknowncountry.com archive is a really extraordinary experience. It's a place where you can regain what we are losing, which is a lost sense of wonder and a willingness and to explore the unknown. We live in a terribly difficult world right now. This place is an oasis of wonder. Join unknowncountry.com today. We're talking to William Stillman. His new book, The Practicing Psychic. Are you a psychic? Well, this book is for you. It's filled with useful, practical information about how to carry on your practice well and honestly and effectively. Also, if you want to become a psychic, we're going to ask Bill in a few minutes what his most basic idea is. In other words, are there books to read that he come to mind and so forth? But that's not really what the show is about today. You can reach Bill at williamstillman.com, on his Facebook page, William Stillman Psychic Medium, or on YouTube, William Stillman, user William Stillman. And you will find, I think, especially on the YouTube channel, some truly fascinating stuff. And on his, you can get in touch with him through his Facebook page or on williamstillman.com. William does do readings, and he is managing to do them during COVID. So there, you could do it, a reading, and I'm going to certainly get a reading. I never got one before from William.
We came sort of close to that, I think, the last time.
Yeah, we did, but we didn't do it.
No, we didn't do it formally. It sort of was something kind of spontaneous. It was very interesting.
Yes, it was. And subscribers, do listen to the last show. Just put Stillman into the search engine, and you'll find the show. Now, but let's go back to what we were just talking about before the break. And can you just recap that experience with the phantom? Because I know people who are free dreamlanders and people who are just curious about it. Let's just recap it.
Would it be interesting for them?
Yeah.
Yes. Well, so as I was saying before the break, Whitley, that during this period of time where I was being abused regularly, if not daily, unfortunately, I, in my mind, compartmentalized the concept of God with the occasional Sunday morning for 90 minutes, you know, one time a week only. And I didn't expand that concept to include at any given moment of the day. And so I didn't have a support system within my own family. And so I became very cold and bitter and ugly and very cynical. And as I was saying, you know, this is, I think, very odd for a child, but I became attracted to dark things. And at that time, we're talking early, you know, almost 50 years ago, early 1970s. And so I, you know, then we had, you know, the amazing Kreskin and Gene Dixon, and then everything else was kind of lumped into the category that was called the occult. That was a popular word back then. So that included, you know, witchcraft and demons and vampires and werewolves and all. And that's the stuff I got attracted to. And I developed a red mark in the center of my palm. It's no longer there, of course. Years later, reading the Book of Revelations, it's referenced in the Book of Revelations, that mark in the center of the palm. The family doctor couldn't explain it. And I remember trying to fall asleep every night, hearing footsteps in my head. And there he was every night, this black silhouette of a man about 6.5 feet tall, black broad-brimmed hat, floor-length black coat. And he would communicate telepathically to me. And he was there for the express purpose of seducing me into recruitment, to join forces with him. And he promised me power over my tormentors, which, as you can imagine, was very attractive for someone being bullied and abused. And I won't go into the story about how that played out, because there was an incident where I got a taste of what that would feel like. But years later, when I was doing research for this book under Spiritual Siege, I was really very surprised to learn that countless other people all over the world have seen the exact same phantom I saw when I was 11, or variations of it, and they have a name for him. They call him the Hat Man. I also want to stress, Whitley, for our listeners, that this was not terrifying. I was not frozen with fright. It was unnerving and it was unpleasant, but to be terror-stricken would have undermined his own agenda, and his agenda was for me to join forces with him.
You know, it's fascinating, you know, to me on two levels. First, I know people who have joined forces with this entity, and it's very scary. That's one thing. And another thing is, when you were mentioning the hat and the Hat Man, I immediately thought of a show that's on Netflix right now called Midnight Mass. It's a series about what could be charitably described as a somewhat crazed priest in a little town on a little island who turns out to be to have allied himself with this entity, this dark entity that has a hat on and pulled down over his eyes. And
I think he's a recruiter.
I don't often watch television, and I'd like you to, you know, since we've sort of segued into this, to talk a little bit about violence in media and being a psychic, because I know I've had the same experience that you have. I cannot watch violent media anymore at all.
I can't
tell
anymore.
Tell us about that and why.
But it's interesting you bring that up, because during that period of time where I became really blocked up spiritually and was attracted to dark things, as I said, you know, the Exorcist film had just come out. I read everything I could get my hands on about that. And then, you know, all of the zombie movies, the horror movies, the Friday the 13th and so on. I couldn't wait for the next installment of those movies to come out. I can't imagine doing that now.
And I used to write that stuff.
I know you
I
did.
I can't imagine doing it now either. I couldn't write it for on a bet.
Well, I just wanted to give a little shout out for people watching because I went and pulled out my first edition of Communion that I bought 30 some years ago, and it was very thought provoking at that time and remains a classic. So I just wanted to give a little shout out about that. But I have to be. That's part of keeping fit across three domains of my personhood every day: mental, emotional, physical, spiritual well-being. So where the mental emotional is concerned, I never deceive by lying, not even white lies. As a general rule, no cursing or swearing. Sometimes I relapse a bit because I'm human, but not language I use in everyday conversation. But the other piece of that is have to be mindful of what I allow myself to be exposed to in terms of viewing material so I don't become corrupted or jaded. And I, in writing the book that we had been talking about, Under Spiritual Siege, I did look at some clips on YouTube that were outtakes of some of, you remember about 10 years ago, there was this trend of like horror movies that were about torturing people and so on. And mercifully that's passed, I think, for the most part.
I don't remember because I never watched any of them.
I did watch some clips from those and it just, I was trembling. I felt nauseated. These things have an effect on people.
I think they do. I think they have a tremendous, you know, I think that they are, one of the things that they are doing is that they are anesthetizing us to real violence, both in our personal lives and in the world around us.
Oh, I think
we're becoming more accepting of it.
I think that's a given when you look at the escalation of, you know, random mass shootings in this country. I think that's a given, Whitley. And not only that, you look at maybe not so much movies and television, but, you know, video games that our young people are playing. It's one of the vehicles that these dark forces or the demonic energies use to sort of establish that slow burn. You know, this rarely happens overnight. It's, you know, they're very sly about it. They're also very cowardly in that they'll target children. They'll target people who are already grappling with their mental health. They'll target people who are addicts. Yep. I just had this conversation the other evening with a young fellow who is, you know, a recovering addict. And there's all kinds of crazy out of control stuff going on in his home. And it wasn't until our conversation that he was able to connect the dots to realize that all of these things that he was seeing in isolation of one another are actually symptoms of a syndrome, an issue that is occurring in his home that is under spiritual siege.
Well, exactly. And I think one of the things they hate the most is freedom. And
the thing they hate the most is truth.
At truth.
To illuminate the truth.
Very much
to when you illuminate the truth and you illuminate the truth about yourself, you don't give them anything to work with. If you are going to be transparent and open and honest about all of your faults and your frailties and your vulnerabilities, you don't give them anything to work with.
You know, something you said earlier I thought was very wise about looking into, and I'm paraphrasing now, both the things you've done on the good side and on the bad side and finding your peace with all of it. Could you tell us a little bit more about this practice? And it is literally a practice, I know.
Well, it's sort of, you know, getting out ahead of what we all ultimately have to experience, which is a life review. That typically occurs in the heavenly realm or the afterlife, but to instigate that process here. And I do want to tell you, Whitley, I want to thank you for having this conversation because a lot of people in this field don't want to talk about the dark side. They don't want to talk about the negative energies and so on. But in my opinion, you have to know what you're up against. You have to know what you're dealing with because the goal, they thrive on chaos and destruction. And if you're a psychic working in this field or a medium, you have to know this because they want to take you down. They want to cause you to become undone and they want to prevent you from manifesting your gifts for the greater good.
Why do they?
They have an agenda of chaos and destruction. That's their agenda.
You know, I used to spend, when Annie was still with me physically, we had a friendship with Shirley MacLaine. And we would go to dinner together in this beautiful restaurant up on Pacific Coast Highway called Jeffrey's. And in that, we were with a celebrity. We got the absolute best table overlooking the Pacific at the sunset and everything. When we went by ourselves, they didn't care anymore, and they put us anywhere they pleased. But in any case, we would sit out there for hours, and I would listen to Annie and Shirley talking about the light and the dark under the stars. And Shirley would always say that what the dark wants is a return to the silence that was before anything happened. Is that the motive, ultimately, essentially, entropy? Or is there another more malignant motive even than that?
In my opinion and my experience, the motive is more malignant than that. It is to curtail, to retard, to prevent each human being from manifesting their God-given gifts and talents in a manner that will be of service to others.
To take them down.
To mute them, to diminish them, to snuff them out. Ultimately, and this is going to be alarming, or maybe not, maybe our listeners are already aware, ultimately what they want is to escalate the situation within each given environment where under spiritual siege is occurring. They want to escalate it to the point where the stage is set for a murder or suicide to occur. And this young man who was in his 30s, who I was counseling the other night, was saying, yes, I've thought of harming myself on many occasions since all of this has happened. You know, when in worst case scenarios, yeah, people are being bitten and scratched. And as your listeners may know, the scratches occur in strikes of three on people's flesh. It's a mocking of the Holy Trinity.
That's interesting. And Free Dreamlanders, here's something that is not as interesting, but we're going to do it anyway. We're going to let you listen to a few commercials. We'll be right back. This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi, in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. We're talking to Bill Stillman, William Stillman. His website is williamstillman.com. His Facebook page is William Stillman Psychic Medium. His YouTube channel is user William Stillman. And there's a lot of value, especially if you are a practicing psychic or you have been on a journey that the dark side has come after you, like Bill has. And look at what we have here is a man who has bridged that gap and come into the light. In fact, if he could open his blinds, he would be in the light, but he can't do that or he'll blow out the camera. So in any case, he's in the light. Now, I want to get into some of the you have in the book, in excuse me, folks. My listeners know that as time goes on, my allergies are getting worse and worse and worse. You have in the practicing psychic a lot of good advice for people who are actually practicing, and I think it's a good moment, given what we've been discussing previously, to talk a little bit about your ideas about protection. And well, let's start in another place. Let's start with good and bad motives for psychic work. In other words, there may be motives for being a psychic that aren't as good as the best motives. Can you discuss a little bit about your ideas about good and bad motives for doing psychic work?
You bet, Whitley. You know, I've been doing psychic work for probably over 20 years now, but professionally, I'm going into my 18th year this year. And when I started out, I'm in the Harrisburg, Hershey, Pennsylvania area. There was only one other person of whom I was aware that was doing this work. And now, these years later, there are probably about a dozen. So I've seen a real insurgence of people, not just in my state, but just nationally, people who are coming into this field, which is really my motivation for having written The Practicing Psychic, because there was no code of ethics. There's no Hippocratic oath for psychics and psychic mediums. And I desired to put something out there to really let people know that, look, this is serious. And if you're a medium, and as you know, and your listeners know, there's a difference between being a psychic and being a psychic medium. But, you know, if you're a medium, it's really serious stuff, because people are coming to you with such high expectations of your ability to connect to deceased loved ones. You have to take this very seriously. And I'm not suggesting that we can't have fun and that there can't be lighter moments and we can't laugh as well as cry. But I wanted to let people know that if you're thinking of doing this, or you are doing it because you want to be seen as in some way superior to other people, you want to shock and awe people, you want to receive all kinds of attention and accolades, you're in it for the wrong reasons. That's not why we do it. We do it because it is the proper response to honoring the God-given gifts and talents that you have been able to discern and employ to be of service to others. So there's the short answer to if you're someone that should get into it or someone that should get out of it. If you're in it because you desire to work through humility to be of service to others, I never charge for missing person or unsolved homicide cases. I'm able to heal people with my hands, pull pain out of their bodies, and take a couple minutes. I never charge for that. You know, there are things that we need to be doing to honor our good fortune, to honor our good fortune in service to others as we allow God, the universe, higher power, source, Wonder Woman, whatever you want to call it, I don't care. But it's working through us, not from us.
You know, in the Gospel of Mary, which I read for my book, Jesus, A New Vision, God is not called God. God is called simply the good.
I like that.
Yeah, me too. I think it's the way to go. And, you know, I have a very intense relationship with this level of being, and who appears to me quite frequently now as a dog. And that goes back to when I was meditating once when Annie was alive, back in about 2008, I guess. And I saw in my mind's eye this big shambling dog come up to me, whom I recognized as a dog who was a very tragic dog, because he was the dog of a family whose father had PTSD from terrible experiences in the Korean War. We didn't know what PTSD was in those days, and then he beat the dog off terribly, and eventually the dog died, and he was the sweetest, no matter what condition he was in, no matter how much he suffered, he was always there for you, and he was always happy. And I said that this dog showed up. I haven't thought about him since I was a teenager. And she said, "Dog, God, you had a visit from God." And I said, "Oh, I'm going to have a sign if I'm going to believe that." The dog's name was Quagmire. And we went out for our afternoon walk a little while later. And there on the street was a car with the vanity plate, Q-G-M-I-R-E, Quagmire. And I thought, wow, that's cool. And since then, this dog, not that dog, but many different forms, and each form represents another kind of conversation. In other words, each breed. If I see a dog in my mind's eye and I look up the characteristics of the breed, I understand the message that's being conveyed.
That's fascinating.
This is very like what you do, isn't it?
That's fascinating. And you know, the beauty of it is, Whitley, that the manner in which we receive information will be tailored to each of us uniquely and individually apart from one another.
Right. And I had a wonderful relationship with a dog when I was a little boy, my dog Candy, who would show up from time to time so vividly in when I was sleeping at night that I would think Candy was actually there. And I would be petting her and stroking her as I used to when I was a little boy. And then I would think, gosh, how old Candy is. And then I would think, well, wait a minute. She must be 60. And then she would disappear, of course. But she was so vividly there that, and I guess this presence, the good, picked up on that. And as I'm talking to you, I'm realizing I need to do this better.
Nice.
You know, this is very helpful to me.
Very nice.
You're actually working now. You're not even consciously, but maybe it is conscious. I don't know, but you are instructing me as we talk.
Beautiful. Well, you know, as you've been talking, I know you've been talking about dogs, but I'm also getting a bear for some reason, and I don't know what the significance of that might be.
Well, Annie always talked about the great bear being women's stars, because they were in Greece, ancient Greece, considered the great bear was considered the stars of women. And the women's stars, my God, what is happening here? are protective. Look.
Well, I want to let our listeners know also, if I may, and I don't know if I'm breaching confidentiality here, but before we started this, we were talking about our respective ages, and you were saying that, you know, you feel like you've done all that you can do, and you're ready to go. And I said, you know, I've felt the same way sometimes. And you said, well, you're too young at almost 60. And you said, I'm 76 or 77. And, but now, you know, maybe there's a little bit of a realization that there's more to be explored yet, and perhaps more to pursue, not necessarily
so.
Personally, but also, you know, you have a platform, you have followers, you have people that
beautiful platform, and all of these people who care very much about what I'm saying and doing. And
you have an influence, you have a responsibility through the influence to disseminate good and great information for the purpose of enlightening and inspiring countless numbers of people, Whitley.
Yes.
It's so powerful and so important.
Well, it is powerful. I mean, it's powerful right now, that's for sure. Let me ask you this. The next thing we were going to talk about was protection for work, and it seems a really good moment to talk about it. Tell us about what a psychic, a practicing psychic, should do to establish a state of protection around the life of the psychic, which is a vulnerable life, because there's a lot out there that does not like you.
Exactly. Guys.
And also the client and the reading.
Yes, it's an excellent question, and it's a great segue from the discussion we had prior to the last break about all of that dark stuff that wants to cause us to become undone. But again, this is a concern that I have for people who are very new to the field, who are maybe psychics or mediums or card readers or whatever it is they're doing. But my gosh, you've got to protect yourself prior to doing any of this high vibration work, because again, these energies, they can be very duplicitous, very deceptive, very insidious in how they operate. They can convince you that they're an angel or a loved one. But the thing about it, though, that's so fascinating is that because their agenda is nefarious, their manifestation will always be imperfect. So there will always be something they'll get wrong. So, you know, you may think you're seeing your deceased grandma, but her eyes are brown when they were blue in life, or she's missing some fingers, or, you know, they'll always get it wrong. But my gosh, if, you know, again, if you want to call it God or the good or whatever you call it, my gosh, it's so important to say a blessing, to protect yourself, to bless the room. You don't need anyone else to do this. You do it. You have a direct line to God. You do it. Bless the room. I always cast a veil of protection over the space, a glorious luminous shield that will defend and protect and repel and deflect anything that is not for the greater good. So important. And you all right?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Okay.
I was very moved, and I'm still vibrating.
That's,
go ahead.
That's not a bad thing. Yes.
And no, then, I don't think so. I'm here to be moved and by my guests.
Beautiful.
I don't have people on the show that don't interest me.
Beautiful. And then I also say a separate blessing with my clients. But as part of my prep, I ask for support in pacing myself so that each receives his or her own. And yet I do not hemorrhage my own personal reserve of spiritual energy. I ask to experience self-forgetfulness for the duration of time that I am in the space, such that I become divorced from ego and devoid of personal bias and prejudice.
Now, how do you do that specifically? Because I think that's a very important part of
it. I just ask it. And the curious thing about that is that I develop an almost immediate amnesia about 98% of the work that I do. I couldn't tell you, this week I did two days of back-to-back in-person sessions, and last Sunday I did a gallery event. I couldn't tell you anything about what happened. So it actually creates like a buffer or maybe a firewall for me that is something of a protection to help to preserve me.
I can understand that very clearly. And Free Dreamlanders, I hope you understand these commercials. They've snuck up on you this time. This is the last group of commercials in the show, folks.
There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle.
We're talking to Bill Stillman, William Stillman. His website, williamstillman.com. His Facebook page, William Stillman Psychic Medium. His YouTube channel, user William Stillman. We're talking about his book, The Practicing Psychic.
Whitley,
guide for staying grounded, navigating skeptics, and honoring your gift. When you say honor, Bill, what do you mean by that word?
Yeah. Just, I think you're only as good as the quality and degree with which you comport yourself with other people. So it's really just not taking anything at all for granted. Conducting yourself with authenticity across all environments, just not when you're working. If I may back up just a moment, there was one last thing that I do as my preparation that I wanted to get in there. We were talking about pacing myself. We were talking about experiencing self-forgetfulness. The other thing that I ask, because I am a medium, is that I will allow the deceased loved ones of all of my clients, separate and apart from one another, to come forward through me, so long as it represents God authentically, so long as it serves the greater good of the highest order, so long as it represents all that is right and true and good and kind, and lastly, so long as it is helpful, healing, humorous, and honorable. I will allow for it for the duration of time that I am in the space only. So it's very important that people recognize that you have to turn on, and then when you're finished, you turn off. And that, and we now return to black and white, like in The Wizard of Oz.
Right. Now, one of the things that a couple of things. What is I'm going to ask you about different processes now. What is psychometry?
That's a fascinating area. Psychometry, and for me, it's been a bit hit or miss with psychometry. But one of my students has actually launched a practice where she specializes in psychometry. And that is simply receiving intuitive impressions about someone, living or deceased, by holding an object that they have personally owned and used, such as a piece of jewelry, a ring, a watch, sometimes, you know, grandpa's pocket knife, for example, that sort of thing.
Yeah, that's why I wear Anne's ring, because it's a link between us. It's also a symbol of the fact that we're still together, but only have one body at the moment. So... Now, you speak of this involving what you describe as a magnification of the senses. What exactly is that?
Spidey sense. So it's all the clairs, and I'm sure that you know, most of your listeners are familiar with the clairs. So we're talking about clairvoyance, which is the input of visuals. I get pictures, movies, words, phrases, names. We're talking about clairsentience, which is a gut feeling, a knowingness. You don't know how you know, you just know. We're talking about clairaudience, which is receiving internal noises, sounds, music, occasionally voices. Clairalliance, which is the fleeting aroma that someone would associate in memory with a loved one. And that's one of the ways in which loved ones in spirit communicate with us as well. Clairgustance, which is the taste on the tongue of something you would associate.
You talk about that taste on the tongue a lot in the talk about that. That one was really surprised me. I'd never been aware of that before.
Well, I'm blessed in that I have all the clairs. So it's a magnification in a spiritual way to be receiving input that builds upon all of our human senses. Where the clairgustance is concerned, and oftentimes it's paired with the clairalliance, which is the scent or the aroma. The best case scenario is I get a lot of mothers and grandmothers come through that are making food, and it's their food, which is fascinating. And sometimes there's an ethnicity to it, which is great. So I may see what they're making. I may smell it. I may taste a little bit of it, but I may not be exactly aware of how it fits. So I was sitting with a client the other day saying, your grandmother is making some sort of spicy rice mixture, but it's being wrapped in a leaf. And she knew exactly what it was, you know?
Right.
Other instances, grandmother is getting ready to bake a birthday cake and someone's birthday is coming up in a couple of weeks, or they're making their homemade, you know, oatmeal raisin cookies, which I appreciate. And then worst case scenario is I'm tasting blood in my mouth and someone will say, he put the barrel of a gun in his mouth and pulled the trigger, you know, but that comes with the territory. That's part of the job.
What about suicide? What about it?
Well, I've come perilously close to suicide myself, and my youngest.
No, so have I.
Yeah, I don't think that's unusual for sensitive people. You know, the world hurts. The world hurts. The world can be an inordinately overwhelming place to be, and you know, the past several. 4, 5, 6 years have been really tough for those of us who are very sensitive people.
Yes.
You understand. My youngest brother did take his life, and it's not that he couldn't endure, it's that he endured as long as he could. So go ahead.
He had a lot of trouble, and it's mentioned, folks, in the book, in the practicing psychic, but it's not really what we're here to talk about. But in a sense it is, because being open to the pain of others is so important in your field. You have to live in that pain often, don't you?
Well, again, I'm really blessed. And again, I think there's that buffer or firewall for me that I can feel it in the moment. I think a big part of my job is to be an impartial third party and to create a professional distance. But that doesn't always work, because I often tear up a bit right along with my clients. But fortunately, as I said before, I don't remember most of what I do, and that's probably a blessing. I've also learned that when I come home after a long day of work, I must take a shower before I go to bed. And I learned that the hard way, because otherwise I'm tossing and turning all night. I have to stand there and just rinse everything off of me and send it all down the drain. It's probably metaphoric as well as, you know, physical.
But it might not be metaphoric on another level. In other words, when I've gone out of my body a few times, I I'm too much of a prankster. Whoever controls that process won't let me do it on my own. I don't think they trust me, but they will take me out. And when they do that, it's extraordinary because it's a completely clear separation. And I see all kinds of things in the world that we don't see in the physical state. And I wonder if you probably do see them, though, even in the physical state, don't you? Or is the world look the same to you?
Only when I'm turned on. Only when I'm turned on. When I'm turned off, there are glimmers of things here and there, but I really make a concerted effort to establish that line of demarcation and to implement those boundaries.
What about reading for people who are close to you? I know this. You touch on this as well in the practicing psychic.
Yes, that's something that I don't do. I will not read for family, friends, neighbors. I will tell you this, and it relates to this, Whitley, is there have been a number of times, and this has been fascinating. There have been a number of occasions where I have told people, "You're not from here originally." I have had to say, being human is a foreign experience for you. And I believe that you are most accustomed to belonging to another race of beings that are not of this world. And not one of these clients has ever said, "You're crazy, that's ridiculous." They have all burst into tears. Because it resonates, they look like you would think they would. They look like this. They have big eyes, little dots, two dots for a nose, a little slit for a mouth, and they don't understand aggression. They don't understand manipulating others for power. They're terribly concerned and upset about how we're degrading our planet and expending our resources, and they've always felt socially ostracized. And that's been fascinating. Hasn't happened very often, but enough times for me to remember that it does happen.
I think there are people in this world who are connected to other worlds in deep ways. I think I probably am in myself.
There have been several instances where I've actually channeled one of these, and that was completely unexpected and entirely fascinating.
Well, tell us a little bit about it, or in fact, actually, what has happened here, Free Dreamlanders, is appalling for you, because we've come to the end of the free part of the show, just at this marvelous moment. So
it's a cliffhanger.
Here's the route of march. If you've listened this long, go ahead and subscribe and get more. And remember, if you can't afford it, if you generally can't afford it, we'll give you a subscription. So, you know, just send a request to subscribers@unknowncountry.com. We don't ask you to prove anything. If you wish to do that and be dishonest, that's your problem. Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much for being with us, as always, on Dreamland. We've been talking to William Stillman, the practicing psychic, williamstillman.com. William Stillman, Bill's Facebook page is William Stillman Psychic Medium. His YouTube channel is User William Stillman. Join us again on Dreamland next week. Okay, Bill, let's go on with.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.